Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Welcome, my friend. Welcome to the Tuesday edition here of Bible Tract Echoes, and the same title for each and every one of our Tuesdays does apply for this one. This is our Tract and Truth Tuesday. Tract and Truth. Obviously, that word tract is a reference to a gospel tract. That word is spelled T-R-A-C-T. A gospel tract is a short written presentation of God's plan of salvation. It's a great evangelism tool, and that's what we produce here at Bible Tracts Incorporated, and we want to give you some gospel tracts absolutely free. I'll say more about that here in just a moment. My Bible right now is open to the Gospel of John chapter 1, to some very familiar verses, I'm sure, I hope, for every one of you. Today is the first Tuesday in the month of December, so I've got two of our tracts that really are used at Christmas time in a particular way. One is called Christmas characters. The other one is simply called The Gift. I want to highlight them here in just a moment, but let me lead into Tract and Truth Tuesday this way. Many people, as I'm out and about in churches to preach, tell me how they enjoy hearing my stories of sharing the gospel. Well, a couple of weeks ago, I was traveling and I stopped in for lunch at McDonald's, of course. I'm a pretty cheap date and when I'm paying the bill. And at the table next to me was a guy with a shirt on it that had a logo about an electric company. I asked him if he was an electrician. He says he was, and his name was Ed. Well, I asked Ed this question. Ed, why does electricity work? He looked at me, he studied my face for a moment. I don't know what he was looking for, but then he had this big smile on his face, and he said something like this. Well, I can and I can't tell you why electricity works. I can't tell you why the electrons in the circuit get all excited and make a light bulb work, but he said, I do know that unless a person turns on the light switch, nothing happens. Well, that, my friend, was my opening, and in a moment, I'll tell you the rest of the story. Get your Bible open to John chapter 1. Get something on which you can jot some notes just to jot down our contact information. I mentioned the Christmas gospel tracts. Now, this is a tremendous time of year to be sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. So many more people are open to hearing about Jesus because he is the reason for the season. As is often said, people are far more attuned to the fact that Jesus is important at this time of year. Two of our tracts, one called Christmas Characters, these two tracts, the other one called The Gift, are a tremendous tool to put in your Christmas cards to hand out to clerks in the store or whatever. The tract entitled Christmas Characters talks about the various characters God used in the first Christmas story and why they were, well, they were unfit for the job. If God Almighty's coming to earth in flesh, you would think he would pick just the creme de la creme of people to utilize, but a utilized people that, well, would have been pushed to the side and marginalized, but yet they became powerful tools in the God's plan. Obviously, God himself came born of a virgin in baby form. That is a humbling thing, but Christ came to do a humbling work, didn't he? He came to die on the cross for sinners. The other tract called The Gift has a beautiful picture of a gift on the outside and just emphasizes the fact that salvation is a free gift from God. You need these tracts, especially here at Christmas time. Get them from us, please. You can wait till the end of the program. My announcer will give you three ways by which you can give to us your name and your mailing address. If you'll do that, we'll send you a free sample pack of our gospel tracts, one each of all of our English tracts. If you'd like to have some Christmas tracts, you need to ask for those specifically to get them and how many you want. If you cannot wait till the end of the program, please just go to our website, which is BibleTractsInc.org. You know how to spell Bible. The word tracts, again, is T-R-A-C-T-S, and then the letters I-N-C, BibleTractsInc.org. Well, the Gospel of John chapter 1, beginning at verse 6, says this: "There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light," capital L, "that all men through him might believe. That was the true light," verse 9 says, "which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, but his own received him not. But as many as received him," that is Jesus, "to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." Stop right there. A couple of weeks ago, a pastor called me and asked me this question: "Brother Mark, should we let a young, immature believer be the teacher of a class filled with mature believers?" And then he quickly added these words. He said, "Mark, don't give me a quick answer." Well, of course, my immediate answer would have been no. I would have said that immature believers need to be taught by mature ones. Well, my pastor friend was letting a man only 2 weeks old in Jesus teach a class of very mature men. Oh, but you need to know this. The class was on evangelism and soul winning. You see, the new babe in Christ was telling everybody he could find about how Christ had saved his soul from sin, death, and hell. Well, the class of mature men, well, sad to say, those mature men had not told anybody the gospel in a very long time. In this situation, the pastor did a pretty good thing. Those mature men could certainly explain the theology of evangelism. They just didn't do evangelism. This newly saved guy was doing the work, and the lives of many people were being impacted for eternity because he was doing the work of evangelism. So let me ask you, does your local church teach people there how to share the gospel, how to communicate the gospel, how to give out tracts? Is the teacher in your church who teaches evangelism, are they only a theologian on evangelism, or are they a doer of the work? That's a good question. Well, let me come back to my electrician story at McDonald's. When he told me of his explanation and his lack of explanation of how electricity works, I took out a napkin and I drew on it three objects. Number one, a light bulb. Number two, a square representing a battery. And number three, a switch. I then said something like this: "Ed, let me make sure I've got this right. To make electricity work, I first need a source, right?" Ed agreed with me. Then I said, "I need a receiver of the power. In this case, in my picture, it's a light bulb." Ed agreed with me. Finally, I said, "Well, I need a connector that allows the power from the source to get to the receiver." In my case, on the napkin, my connector was this switch. And this is where I went into a gospel presentation. I described people as being like the light bulb. They are beautiful on the outside, but they're dead and lifeless on the inside. At this point, I explained that Ed was dead. Ed was lifeless on the inside. I told him how that God had made man, but that man had sinned. And now spiritual death has passed upon all men, for all are sinners. I asked Ed about his own personal sin story, and lo and behold, he told me a pretty drab story of his sinfulness. "Ed," I said, "people were made to have fellowship with God, to have life with God. But now, since we're sinners and God is holy, we can't have fellowship with him." Just like that light bulb, I said, just like that light bulb was designed to give light, but it can't because it is lifeless on the inside. And so it is that it cannot fulfill the purpose for which the light bulb was designed. I then shared about God's love for sinners and about His power to save. Only God has the power to bring life, that is, spiritual life, to dead people, spiritually dead people. And along the way, I'm quoting verses that, for all have sinned to come short of the glory of God, the wages of sin is death, and so on. Well, God, I told Ed, is the master electrician. He has personally designed and personally built a power system to make sinful lives, dead lives, to come to life. It was here that I explained who Jesus is. I called Jesus the switch in my eternal life power story. Everything hinges on that switch, I said, and what people do with it. I reminded Ed that he had often installed all the lights and all the wiring and all the switches in many homes, and he had told me about some. But once, I said, once you leave the house, Ed, it's up to the people living there at the house to use the switches to turn on the power and make the lights work. The power is available, but the people living there have to utilize the things that Ed had put into the house. Ed got this picture. He understood it. Jesus, I said to Ed, is the switch in God's plan to give eternal life to people who are spiritually dead. Nothing happens until that switch, that is Jesus, is used. Well, friend, Ed saw the picture. He got it. He understood it. He turned to me and he said these words, and I'm quoting, I remember these words very clearly. He said, "Mark, I need Jesus to save my life, don't I?" That tells me, without a shadow of a doubt, Ed got it. "Mark," he said, "I need Jesus to give me life, don't I?" At this point, I opened my Bible to Romans 10, 9 and 10. Where it talks about that, "If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." I used those verses to show him how to receive Christ as his Savior. And he did, right there in McDonald's. We had been sitting at two separate tables next to each other. I moved over to his table as we were looking at Romans 10, 9 and 10. He was there that he prayed out loud and asked Jesus to save him from his sin. I then, when he got done, I prayed as well. I then showed him John chapter 1, verse 12, how that God gives the power to sinners to become sons of God, but only to those who believe. So tell me, you that are listening right now, what have you done with Jesus? He is the switch that has to be utilized for everlasting life, for power for life, eternal life, to come into your life. Have you used Jesus? He's the only one that can get the power source in God Almighty from where he is into your life. You may be beautiful like a light bulb on the outside, but until you come and by faith receive Christ as your Savior, turn the switch on, because Christ is the source of life. That's why he died on the cross, shed his blood. He rose from the dead to prove to you he'd give you eternal life. Have you cried out to him? Have you called upon Christ to save you from your sin? You need to do that, and do it right now. Get the tracts from us. Let's share the gospel at Christmas time that people might be saved from their sin.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888. And our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve Him.